Good evening. My name is Dave Frank. Welcome to my 13th Internet Masterclass. I'm extremely grateful tonight to be presenting a class on my teacher, the great pianist and jazz educator Lennie Tristano. I had the good fortune of studying with Lennie for 6 years in the 1970s, and it was just a great experience growing up with such a great musician and a great person. I'm coming to you tonight from Hari NYC, which is a jazz yoga space right in the middle of Manhattan at 140 West 30th Street. And I'm going to start the class as usual by playing a little bit. You can find the notes for tonight's class on my website, www.davefrankjazz.com. And you can download those notes and read along. There is a button, as I always say, probably right around here, where if you'd like to fast forward this segment, you may. This is going to be about, maybe 6 or 7 minutes, but I'd like to play something for Lennie tonight. Thank you for joining me, and I look forward to a real groovy evening. Thank you. read along with the notes with me if you like. Lennie Tristano, 1919 to 1978, was one of the great jazz genius innovators of the 20th century. Among other things, Lennie was one of the pioneers of the cool school of jazz of the 1940s and 50s, made the first use of overtracking in audio recordings, conducted the first experiments in free jazz group playing, and pioneered the walking bass line style of jazz solo piano playing. Blind from the age of 9, Lennie was also among the first jazz educators to establish a complete system of teaching improvisation on all instruments, and had a thriving teaching studio in the New York City area until his death in 1978. Lennie's piano playing was the expression of a tremendous but relaxed spiritual power, daring harmonic and melodic elements, humor, and a shocking originality. His playing has influenced countless jazz pianists, including Bill Evans, Keith Jarrett, and Herbie Hancock. In this class, we will focus on Lennie's solo playing and on some of his innovations in both solo and group contexts. I first met Lennie when I just turned 15. I was studying at the Berklee College of Music in Boston, and I was in the library, and a lady came and sat across from me, and she had a copy of this new Tristano record, which you can see here, which was a very rare record. She had found it for $2 or $3 in some bin in Boston. And she was very excited because she was studying with Lennie. And at that time, I was very much looking for a teacher. And I had read about Lennie in a book called Jazz Masters of the 1950s. And I knew that he was teaching nearby where I was living on Long Island. So I asked her about Lennie, and she said he was a great guy, and he was a great teacher, and he was very interested in helping people play jazz. So I decided I was going to call him up. So from the dorm at Berklee, the first conversation I had with Lennie when I was 15 went like this. Hello, Mr. Tristano? Call me Lennie. I need help. What kind of help do you need, David? I need pianistic help. This is what you do. When you get back from Berklee, you come and see me. I live in Queens. And you can come here and play for me, and I'm going to tell you how I'm going to rip you off, and you can tell me to go fuck myself. That was the first conversation I had with Lennie, but it wasn't the last. He was such a powerful figure in jazz and in education. And he had a whole scene of musicians studying around him. And it was just an amazing experience to be in regular contact with a genius at this level. So what I thought I'd do tonight is just, let's listen to a little of his solo playing. And we're gonna first hear one of his classic solo recordings from this record, the new Tristano, entitled Becoming. We'll listen to it and then I'll come back and we'll talk about some of the elements that go into the playing. And then we'll listen to it again, and I'll talk you through it. So this is Lennie Tristano, 1961, Becoming. Thank you. This was recorded about 50 years ago, and to me, this amazing improvisation has lost none of its originality, power, and intensity. That was some real swing and jazz piano. It's almost impossible to believe that one person can create all that music and create it spontaneously. So I thought it would be useful to look at some of the aspects of Lennie's style. And you might, if you know any of these master classes, you might recognize some of this stuff from the Walking Bassline Clinic. But I'll repeat some of it for you tonight in Lennie's context. The first thing we notice about Lennie's playing is the powerful walking bass line. So the walking bass line is primarily a quarter note line, low down on the piano. You can go real low with this bass line. On a big piano like this, it really has a huge sound. It's almost all quarter notes, although there are other things you can do to change it. The idea is that we're making a melodic connection between the roots of the chords. On the Walking Bassline Clinic, we get into this quite extensively. But you're trying to make a simple melody, connecting the roots of the chords as a first way of doing it. Once you learn how to do the roots of the chords, you can use other elements and other degrees of the chord. To this walking bass line, we're going to add a primary eighth note improv line. One of the real secrets of jazz improvisation is that the basic kind of line for improvisation, in this case on the right hand, is a swing eighth line. And Lennie used the swing eighth line as a kind of a linchpin that brought everything together. Swing eighth line goes like this. New York, 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 New York. This is the primary line in improv, and Lennie uses it as a primary jumping off point, and then he'll build the intensity and come back to it. Element that Lennie uses to counter this single note line is what we call right hand chord clusters. And these chord clusters usually have anywhere from 3 to 5 notes, oftentimes 4. And what Lennie's doing is he's creating a melody with the top note of the cluster. Following the chord sequence of What Is This Thing Called Love, like it was a merry-go-round in your head. Lennie would often bring out the top note and the bottom note of the clusters. And that sounds like a big band. The two basic things would create a balance. The single note line, and the clusters. Now, when Lennie wanted to ramp the sound up and the volume and the intensity, he would sometimes bring in triplet lines. And you know, if you've seen any of these classes, that the triplets is Tennessee. Tennessee, 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 Tennessee. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, Tennessee, 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 Tennessee. And then maybe back to the eighth notes. characters. And he's going to switch the intensity of these elements. Maybe back to the single notes. There's a little master controller in your head when you're improvising that tells you exactly in the moment which element to use. And basically, we're looking to control the intensity of the creation. Here we start with the single note lines, eighth notes. Maybe we bring some triplets. Tennessee, 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 Tennessee. Maybe some clusters. More clusters. Single note. All the while following the chord progression. Now, in addition to some of these elements, Lennie also liked to play octave unison lines in the two hands. So Lennie would often do it an octave apart. That sounded like this. And sometimes you can do it two octaves apart. It has a kind of a brighter sound or a bigger sound. And often these unison lines are used as connectors between different parts of the improvisation. Another thing we'll hear in Lennie's playing that's very unique and interesting is kind of a musical mantra, where he'll take one idea and he'll keep turning it around, and in the moment, as he turns it around, the time shifts in an Einsteinian way where it goes across the bar in interesting ways. And so that would sound something like this, and we'll hear this in some of Lennie's solo playing. Like a mantra. Anybody can write in and tell me what he's doing rhythmically, I'd be happy to hear. I don't have the slightest idea. It's like a figure that repeats. Maybe some clusters. Okay, and then the other element I wanted to tell you about are two-hand spread voicings done in rhythmic groups. So Lennie liked this particular rhythm, this chord. C, E, A, D, G, C. And he would often use that in groups of three. Chromatically going down. Tennessee, Tennessee. Sometimes you can go up. Sometimes you can go two octaves. Tennessee, Tennessee, Tennessee. That's real strong. Lennie was such a strong person. As most of you know, he was blind, and he had a very difficult life in many ways. And yet he was all of our teachers and all of our guru, and he would give us all advice on all aspects of music and living. And he was able to do that in spite of his handicaps. And it was such a powerful experience to be in his presence. He had a real enlightened type of a vibe that he gave off. And he would often talk to us about things like meditation and how you keep your mind quiet while you're creating. He was really on top of all those multidimensional aspects of improvisation. It was way ahead of his time. So I hope that gives you some idea of some of the elements that we're hearing tonight in Lennie's playing. And so now let's listen again to Becoming, and I'm going to talk you through it, and I think you'll see how these elements are used. Thank you. It starts out with the bass line. You can feel the pulse right here. The bass line gives you the pulse. Yeah. Kind of a slow tempo. There are some clusters. Always has a melody involved in the cluster on the top and bottom note, at least. Yeah. Back to our single eighth note line. New York, New York, New York, New York, New York, New York, down. Sometimes you use these little turns. Doodle-dee-ya, doodle-dee-ya. That's a real nice aspect that he adds to the eighth note line. Yeah. The power of the playing reflects the power of the person. And he gave that power to so many people to find their own. Yeah. More clusters, still following the same chord sequence. Yeah. Octaves, yeah, and triplets, more clusters. Back to our eighth note line, which always serves as the linchpin. It ties everything together. It's the medium degree of intensity. Back to some clusters, which builds the intensity a little bit. There's a faster line. Yeah. Yeah. Now he's speeding the light up a little bit. Yeah. Sometimes the lines just go across the bar and it doesn't fit any preconceived rhythm. Sometimes it will be eighth notes, triplets, and 16th notes. Here's an octave line. No, clusters, descending. Right. More clusters, two hands. There are those descending chromatic clusters. Yeah. More descending chromatic clusters. This is a beautiful section here. He keeps this note the same twice. Three times. One, two, three. Right. Even four. Yeah. Here's an octave line in the two hands that connects two sections of the piece. Now he's going to start to build the intensity. Yeah. Back to the clusters and the swing eight, the bass line. Yeah, now here's one of the great moments in jazz piano history. He speeds it up. Two, three, four, one, two, get ready, pow. Yeah, same thing but faster. Yeah. Here's like one of those mantras. Yeah, it's all in good fun, but it's pretty serious. Here's a 16th note line. Mississippi, 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 Mississippi. Yeah, man, this is killing. Woo! Yeah. Yeah, triplet line, Tennessee, 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 Tennessee. Woo! Yeah. There's an octave line. He uses all the elements in different ways at different times to create a whole piece of music. And hear how he ends. And he holds that last note and just lets it ring. It's very subtle. Ooh, beautiful. Okay. I hope you enjoyed that. Let's listen to one more of these type of solo pieces. And this time I'll just talk you through it. And this uses very similar elements. It's a little bit faster in a major key. This one is called Deliberation. This is from the same recording, the new Tristano. It is out in some form on CD. often it's combined with Lennie's recording before this one, which was just called Lennie Tristano from 1955. You can sometimes find a two-record set. But any way you find it, I highly recommend this recording. It's one of the great recordings in jazz history. Let's hear Deliberation, and we'll see how that moves. Yeah, so this one's a little bit faster. So you got that bass line swinging. Beautiful. This is based on the changes of Indiana or Donna Lee. Yeah. So we have the left-hand bass line spelling out the rhythm. No question where the pulse is here. Right hand is doing improv lines of different timings, mostly the eighth note, and then he switches to the triplets and sixteenths. Yeah. His timing was so perfect with the bass line. The word on the street is that Lennie, for 1 year, played nothing but bass lines. I don't know if that's possible, but that's what we heard, that as he was developing this ability to play the bass lines, for 1 year he did nothing else but play bass lines. Yeah. It's very pure contrapuntal playing, and this point is just a left-hand bass line, right-hand improv line. Dave McKenna sometimes would add some chords in the middle to make it a little more complicated, but Lennie liked the real abstract kind of Bach contrapuntal lines. There's triplets. Here's a mantra. It's deep, man. Yeah, it's like ecstasy. Not the drug, the feeling. Starting another chorus. Yeah, you can hear the turns on top of the line. Yeah, here we have a double time line. Check it out. Woo! Goes on. Every note's in its perfect place. Mississippi, 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 Mississippi. Yeah. And he ends it right on the dime. Pow! He always used to tell us to put that note right at the end. Pow! Especially when you're playing a double time line. Yeah. Now he brings some clusters in. It changes the texture, makes it thicker. Yeah. Beautiful. Good. Now it's another chorus. Now he's going to go back to the. Yeah, here we go. Single note line. Yeah. Clusters. Hear how he moves them around. Back to the single notes. Here, double time line. Yeah. Woo. That is complex, man. Woo. Double. Pow. Yeah, there's a mantra. Yeah. More double time. Woo! Man, those fingers are flying. Incredible piano technique. Every note perfectly placed with the perfect touch. He's just expressing pure intensity. Yeah. And so he slows it down. You see how he brings it up? He brings the intensity level up, and then he brings it down. It's like driving a shift car. You're shifting up, you're shifting down, always coming back to second gear, which is the eighth note line. Yeah, now he's going towards the end with big clusters and rhythms. Yeah, that is deep. It brings to an ecstatic ending. baby.
Yeah.
That is great piano playing, man. Okay. I have a couple of more surprises in for you this evening. I want to turn to one of Lennie's lesser known improvisations. And this improvisation is called Descent into the Maelstrom. This is actually Lennie's musical portrait of a short story by Edgar Allan Poe. And the story is about a boat in a hurricane. And we just had a hurricane in New York, so we all know what that feels like. I don't remember, I didn't see any boats going down Second Avenue, but we saw the hurricanes. And so this is a story of, I think it was three sailors in a boat getting caught in a hurricane and twisted around, and somehow at the end it seemed to work out okay. So this is one of the most far out pieces of music ever conceived, and what we're going to hear is some number of pianos overtracked. So it's probably, who knows, three, four, five pianos. But this was done in the early, early days of overtracking. Lennie was the first guy to try that in a group context. And this piece is completely atonal far out and was recorded in 1953, which is well before the popular free jazz experiments of the late 1950s and 60s. So this is kind of like looking in Da Vinci's notebooks, and then you see all of a sudden in the middle of all these beautiful pictures, you see like a helicopter. It's like, this is a helicopter, but wait, it's only like 400 years before the helicopter started. This is kind of like what Lennie was doing. This is way ahead of his time, and I'm going to play it all the way through for you, and then we're going to talk briefly about it, but there's not much that needs to be said about this piece. But it is called Descent into the Maelstrom. Lennie Tristano, 1953.
Thank you.
Is there anybody left out there? I just want to point out a couple of things that he was doing to create this outrageous tapestry of sound. And to me, I can really hear that hurricane. So first thing is he had these, most of the piece had this rumbling bass pattern. This is totally atonal, so there's no key center. And what he would do is he would put all kinds of tremolos on top. Just however he felt it at the time. And he would also use these kind of two-level jumping chords. Cecil Taylor, hello. He would use a lot of high atonal melodies. And he kind of put them all together in a multi-track. He liked doing glissandos, up or down. And he would do repeated chords and clusters like this. Yeah, man. That is wild. Okay, that's just some of the things that you might hear there. We're not going to listen to that one again, but we are going to listen to one more piece. And this is another incredible innovation of Lennie's, in that he was also the first band leader to experiment with free jazz playing. And free jazz playing is when there's no set chord sequence, like the pieces that we heard at the beginning were all based on chords, sequences of standards. This kind of free playing is something that was radically new at the time, and this is where you just put a group of guys in a room and you just say play, and then it's the natural intuition of human beings in the same place at the same time that can create a spontaneous work of art. And it's very interesting and unusual to have a group of people playing together and improvising something brand new. When we heard the solo recordings, we heard Lennie himself at the piano. Now we're going to hear the Lennie Tristano group, and we're going to hear a piece called Digression from 1949. This is the helicopter in Da Vinci's notebooks. So let's listen a little bit, and I'll talk you through it, and this will be the last selection for the evening. This is the Lennie Tristano group, Digression, 1949, if you can believe it. Okay, this starts with a beautiful atonal piano introduction by Lennie. He has a melody that shifts from the top to the bottom, left, right hand to left hand. Sometimes he answers himself, he creates a phrase in the right hand and then answers it in the left hand. The beautiful combination of musical textures of chords and single notes, right hand and left hand doing different combinations of chords and notes. And now we have Lee Konitz coming in with a melody, and Lennie imitates it. This is musical telepathy. There's nothing planned. There is one instrument at a time coming in. Now we have the guitar coming in, Billy Bauer. Lee Konitz was playing beautiful alto on this. You can feel the pulse of the music. That's one of the things that holds it together. Yeah. Lennie starts a melody. And he adds to that melody. It swells, it rises, and it falls. There's a beautiful melody by Lennie. There's a melody. Answer. have the great Warren Marsh adding to the fray. And we have a musical texture, mostly eighth notes. New York, New York, New York. The beat is here. And we're just creating melodic movements, ascending and descending. Here's triplets. One, two, three, one, two, three. This is really high, high art. There's 16th note from Lennie. There's a new melody. And Lee answered it. Lennie started it, and Lee answered it. The melody lives for a while, it gets imitated a couple of times, and then it dies away. Now we have a swell in the group. It was a swell group. There's something totally different from Lennie. It all works together to create a musical tapestry. Back to the pulse. Everybody's playing the pulse here. Wow. Yeah, that's a beautiful melody. Yeah. Fantastic. All right, Lennie ends it with a beautiful atonal chord. Yeah, and the last note just rings. Beautiful. Okay, gang. Thank you so much for joining me on another one of these musical excursions. If this kind of thing interests you, there are 12 other classes on both YouTube and Ustream on such people as Bill Evans, Frank Zappa, The Grateful Dead, Oscar Peterson, many others. I want to thank my great new crew, Josh and Melissa. Thank you so much for joining me on this journey. And I want to dedicate this class to my bestie friend, the great Batman, Aaron Raetano, who is now fighting a terrible disease in Boston. So this one goes out to you, buddy. And I want to thank Lennie for his generosity of spirit and music that inspired a whole generation of players. If you'd like to reach me for any reason, any positive reason, that is, feel free to write me at davefrankjazz.com. Great to be with you. Our next class is going to be in a totally different direction. We're going to study the piano stylings and lifestyle, incredible costumes, and altogether wackiness of Liberace. So talk about from the sublime to the ridiculous. Thank you for joining me. See you in cyberspace another time. Ciao for now.